I want to welcome everybody to our PolarConnect event. We're really excited today because we'll be chatting with teacher and informal science educator Alex Eilers and a whole slew of team members that work with Weddell Seals in the Ross Sea. Let me try to say that a couple of times.
I can't get it to where
and
there's no sound,
I
guys.
I want to remind somebody that they just joined by phone, and we need you to mute your phone already. Star 6 to mute, and star 6 to unmute. And anyway, today is May 9th, 2016. We're going to go through a few slides here to get you acquainted with this platform, and then we'll turn it over to the team to present about Weddell Seal. So for many of you that are just joining us, this is the Adobe Connect platform that we're using. There's a number of features, but I think mostly you are all discovering them on your own. There's a chat area that you can type your questions in and tell us where you're from and ask questions and also addressing technical issues. There's a list of attendees also on the far left. And as you can see today, we have a couple of presenters that have webcams as well. We'll let them keep their webcams open for a little bit, and then during the presentation, we'll actually have them turn them off, and then we'll bring them back up for Q&A. There's some links at the bottom. If you have a lot of trouble with the Adobe Connect platform and you didn't get a PDF of the presentation, you can actually download that file. There's a link to the file, and there's other links that we might refer to during the presentation or things that we think are of interest to you. If you click on those links and you are not a presenter or a host, you will be fine. It just opens up another window for you to look at those links. Okay, so here's how this works. We want you to introduce yourself in the chat room. I know a bunch of people have been already doing that, saying where their class is from, and also number of students, and we're tracking that as well, and we just gives us an idea of where everybody's coming from. If you haven't been familiar with Polar Trek at all or attended one of these webinars or followed any of the journals online, Alex is part of a program she started many years ago. I'm sure she'll talk about her role in Polar Trek, but it's a program where we send teachers and informal educators like Alex out with researchers like Jen Burns and the team, places like the Arctic and more about polar science. And we've been doing this since 2004, and we're really excited to have teachers go all over the world and be with scientists. And we have a number of teachers that are just starting Arctic expeditions. Jen did her, Alex did her Antarctic expedition just a few months ago, and that's what this presentation is about. During the presentation, you can type your question in the chat box. At the end, we will try hand raising, and we aren't really sure how that works. We had some technical difficulties last week, but for sure, you can always type your question in the chat box, and we'll relay it to the team. All right, that's enough on my end. Before I have Alex start and introducing the team, I want to remind you, if you joined us by phone, it's very important that you mute your phone, star 6 to mute your phone, star 6 to unmute, so that we don't get background noise. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Jen. I mean, Jen, Alex, sorry.
Okay. All right. Awesome. Thank you, everyone. And I am so excited to see all of these attendees and to see the team here. We're very, very excited. All right, so I get to start off this celebration. If you could remember to hit star 6 to mute your phone and star 6 to unmute if you just joined us by phone. All right, so we've got some amazing animals that we are going to be talking about today, the Weddell seal. It is the southernmost living and breeding mammal. It is found only in the waters around Antarctica and on the fast ice, and that is the ice that is along the coastline of the Antarctic continent and the islands surrounding the continent. And it is a true seal, which means it is a member of the Phocidae or Phocidae family. And so we're very excited to be sharing news about the Weddell seal today. So when I go out to classes, everybody always asks me, where are you, where do you sleep, where do you eat, and where do you work? So we'll start out that way. Antarctica is the picture on the upper left-hand corner, and there are actually three U.S. bases that if you are doing research, you go either through or to do your research. So Palmer Station is located on the peninsula, and actually if you go north from there, you will be hitting South America. And then, of course, we probably have arguably the most famous station, the South Pole Station, and that is 90 degrees south latitude. And then McMurdo Station, which is the largest station, and that's where our team was. And actually, if you go north from McMurdo Station, you will run into New Zealand, and that's actually where we went out from. All right, so Ross Island is actually not on the continent itself. It is a kind of a rather large island just off of the coast, and it was actually named after James Clark Ross, and he was a British explorer who discovered Ross Island in the mid-1800s. And then in the picture on the top right, this kind of shows you where we were building in the middle. That is the galley, and that is where we eat, and we spent quite a bit of time in there. You've got the Crary Labs, which are right next to them. I'm going to try my, let's see if I can do the arrow. There we go. There's the arrow. That's where that was our staging area. We got all of our equipment ready there. We had our computers in that lab, and we brought back our samples to that lab. Eventually, those samples went with the team, and they're analyzing them now. And then the images that you see, the brown buildings, that is where we slept. So the old dorms, that was when I was on expedition in 2012 and 2014. And then the new dorm is where we were in 2016. All right. So I'm going to introduce the team. We have an amazing team of scientists. And on the top row, these ladies are all from Antarctica. They're all from University of Alaska at Anchorage. And I apologize, somebody is trying to call in, so I hope you can't hear that. Dr. Jennifer Burns, she is our principal investigator, and she is an associate professor of biology at University of Alaska at Anchorage. And she's the leader of our team. Then next to her, we have Michelle Shiro. Well, we actually get to call her Dr. Michelle Shiro. She actually just got her PhD not too many months ago, and so she is what we call a postdoctoral researcher. And then we have three amazing graduate students, Skyla Walscott, Roxanne Beltran, and then Amy Kirkham. And they will actually all get to share a little bit of their research pieces with you. And I don't believe we have Dr. Rachel on the phone. She is actually in Juneau, Alaska, and she is a vet. And I know this is kind of a busy time of year for her. And then we have Dr. Robert McCorkle. He's also one of the vets on the team, and he is an associate professor at the University of Calgary, and that is in Alberta, Canada, and in the city of Calgary. And then we do have Dr. Greg Adams with us here today. He's also a vet, and he is a professor at the University of Saskatchewan that is in Canada. In fact, it's in Saskatoon, Canada. And then I am the educator on the team and very proud to be. This is really an amazing group of scientists we get to work with. So I'm the manager of education at the Pink Palace Museum in Memphis, Tennessee. And then I get to turn this over to Jen. I was actually on a team with her in 2012, and we actually were still working with Weddell Seals, and we actually put on, I don't know if you can take that arrow and move it over here, there was a satellite tag we were actually gluing on the heads of Weddell Seals. And I'll let Jen tell you a little bit about that project and how that project inspired our current project. Jen?
Thanks, Alex. I hope everybody can hear me. Not hearing otherwise, I'm going to assume that's true. Project that Alex and I got introduced to each other on as a PolarConnect teacher was looking at the movement and diving behavior of Weddell seals. As you can see in that slide, there's a seal in the water. And we were interested in figuring out where they went during the long, dark Antarctic winter. And on the right on that slide, you can see, looks like about a plate of spaghetti got thrown on a map. And that's where the seals that we put instruments on in 2012 went in the Ross Sea. Some of the females that we put instruments on way down in McMurdo Sound, and hopefully somebody can point where McMurdo is, traveled pretty far north, 400 or 500 kilometers north, and all foraging all the time. And then the next year they would come back in the springtime to McMurdo in order for them to give birth to their pups. So they would make round trips of more than 1,000 kilometers during the Antarctic wintertime. Now, one of the things we were doing with that project was that we were putting instruments on the seals. In the picture previously, you saw a seal carrying a satellite tag, and that was glued to their fur. Seals have a fur coat like all mammals do, and we would find seals that had a new fur coat and glue the instrument onto them. And this is really important because in late summer in the Antarctic, the female seals are lying around on the sea ice, and some of them are brown and fuzzy looking, like the seal on the top there that is a not molted seal. And after a few weeks, that seal starts to molt and it sheds its hair, just like if you have a cat or a dog that's going through shedding season, that hair will fall out and they grow a new coat of fur, and they have a new coat every year. Well, since we were gluing things to this fur coat, we wanted to make sure we put it on the new fur coat and not the old fur coat. Otherwise, our tags would fall off really quickly. And when we were doing that, we were walking around looking for seals that had nice, shiny fur coats, like in that molt status picture over on the right. We noticed something that was really interesting, and that was that all of the females that we found that were molted in January, which is sort of late summer in the Antarctic, had not given birth to a pup in the previous couple of months. So females that had given birth to a pup in year one, when we went to look for them later in the summer, they had not molted, and females that had not given birth to a pup in year one had molted. We thought, well, that's kind of interesting. It suggests that there's some interaction between molting and reproduction. And to get at that, we also started looking about whether or not females that had molted in year one, when we handled them, returned the next year to give birth to a pup. And we were asking those questions by looking at females that fell into one of two reproductive categories. Females that were moms in year one, they'd given birth to a pup,
or females that were not moms and had decided to take a year off from reproducing. And we call those females skip females because they could have reproduced, but they just didn't. And so some of the things that we found were that when we looked at the reproductive status of females, we found that, excuse me, I have what my team likes to call the McMurdo cough, and so hopefully that's not too loud and distracting. What we found was that females that had given birth in year one were not pupping, were not molting when we looked for them, and females that had not given birth in year one were fully molted in when we looked for them. And then we found that if they were molted when we looked for them, that they were more likely the next year to give birth to a pup. So females that molted early were more likely to produce a pup the next year. And this is really interesting because one of the questions that we like to ask as biologists is what influences reproductive success or the probability of reproducing a pup each year, because that's going to determine whether or not the population is healthy and growing and able to take care of itself. So we found, given that information, we found that there were links between when a female pup, whether a female pupped in year one, whether they molted early or late in year one, and then whether or not they produced a pup in year two. And females that molted early tended to give birth the next year early, and females that molted late or shed their fur late tended to give birth late in year two. So we had these linkages between pupping and shedding your fur, and that led us to the project that we're working on now, which has some key research questions, which are why would these two events, pupping and molting, be related to each other? So we're asking questions about how animal mass or body condition or hormone levels, or what they're doing, influence the probability that female Weddell seals give birth to a pup, and when they get pregnant, and how likely they are, if they get pregnant, to produce a pup the next year, carry that pup to term, have a successful pregnancy. And so to get at those questions and to do that, we go down to McMurdo Sound, and we go out and we look for females that are, we know to be reproductive mature, so we know that they're between 10 and 20 years old. And we travel around on the sea ice, we're using snow machines or helicopters, and search for our target animals. And we're able to do this in McMurdo Sound because really successfully, because in the area right around where the McMurdo Station is that Alex showed at the start of this presentation, there is a population of Weddell seals that has been studied for a very long time. This population of Weddell seals that's in the area is tagged, and we can read the flipper tags and know whether or not that's a seal that we are interested in handling. Now, when we walk, these Weddell seals are large. They're about 1,000 pounds, which is kind of the size of a small cow. but they don't have any predators in the Antarctic. So they let us walk right up to them, which is really handy for our research team. And to do, so what we do is we walk up to them, we make sure that this is an animal that we want to work with, and then we put a net over the head of the animal to keep it contained, and we give the animal some sedatives, an injection that anesthetizes the animal. And this is one of the reasons that we work with lots of veterinarians. Greg Adams is on the phone today to participate, and we have two other veterinarians we work with. Rachel Berngart is in Juneau, Alaska, and she comes to the field with us. And she's in charge of sedating the animals, and that just keeps them calm during our handling procedures. We want them to be calm so that we are all safe when working with the animal. So in the right side there, you see a sedated Weddell seal on a tarp. It's calm, and it will stay sedated while we handle them, and then they'll wake up as we get done with all of the procedures. One of the things we're very interested in.
Hi, everyone. My name is Skyla. I just started this past year, went down to McMurdo with Jen and her team for the first time. So one of the things Jen mentioned is that our seals weigh up to 1,000 pounds. So we can't just pick up these seals and put them on a scale. So we use this, pictured on the left here is a tripod that we use. We roll our seals onto a tarp and hoist them up into the air using this tripod so we can get an accurate measurement of their weight. And we also do a lot of measurements on our seals using a measuring tape. And I'll talk about that a little later on what we use those measurements for. One of the things that I'm interested in, since our study is revolving around the molt of the seal, I'm looking at how much heat these seals might be losing during that molting process. On the left here is pictured an infrared thermography, which is essentially a picture of how warm the seal is compared to the purple ice you see around it. So you can see the coloration on the seal shows how warm it is. And in each of those black dots we have, we take measurements of the skin temperature and how much heat they're losing in each of those locations using this device that I have pictured on the right. And some of the measurements that we take, I was mentioning before, we use a long measuring tape to measure from the tip of the nose all the way to the tip of the tail. And we also take girth, height, and width measurements at each of the locations that you see pictured here on the slide. And we use these measurements for quite a few different things. We can use them to estimate the surface area across the seal, also the volume of the seal, and in the event that we may not have been able to hoist that seal up and weigh that seal, we can also use these measurements to approximate the weight of the seal, which I think you guys will be experiencing a little later. Here's Amy.
Thanks, Skyla. So my name is Amy Kirkham. I'm another graduate student working on this project. And one of the things I deal with a lot in my graduate research is with samples that we collect from the seals. So when we're in the field, in addition to taking measurements, we also take some small tissue samples that we can bring back to the laboratory and analyze to learn more about what's going on inside the seal's body at different times of year and how that's different between animals that did and didn't have a pup or animals that are molting and are not molting. So we do take some small skin samples that we can look at to see when hair starts growing. You'll see the hair growing inside the skin before that animal will start actually losing any fur. We take blood and muscle samples, and we can analyze those to see how much oxygen they can hold. Because for seals, it's really important to be able to store oxygen in their bodies since they can't breathe when they're underwater. So we like to look at that to figure out how long the seal can go without breathing and how well it can dive. We also take some blubber, whisker, and fur samples. And those we actually use to learn about seal diet, believe it or not. So if you've heard the expression, you are what you eat, that is actually true. And based on what kind of food a seal has been eating, the chemical composition of its blubber or whiskers or fur will be different. We can analyze those to see if a seal has been eating more big fish or little fish, maybe some squid or krill, and learn more about how their behavior differs between different groups and changes across seasons. And I can show you some of the results or things we're looking at with those samples as well. So in this slide, I mentioned before, we look at oxygen stores in the blood. If you look all the way at the left, you can see here's two blood samples. One is from a human and one is from a Weddell seal. And in those samples, the red blood cells have been separated out from the liquid part of the blood. And you can notice those red blood cells, which look dark, there's a whole lot more of them in the Weddell seal blood than the human blood. So we measure how much red blood cells there are, or the hematocrit of all the seal blood we take samples of, to figure out which seals can carry more oxygen and can go for longer without having to take a breath. Another thing we look at in the blood samples are hormones. So hormones are chemical messengers that travel through the bloodstream. And we're looking at a whole bunch of different ones that are related to reproduction and nutrition and molt. And here are some results from the animals we handled in November and December. We learned that progesterone, which is a hormone that is progestation, so it helps a female animal get ready for gestation or pregnancy, is higher in the skip seals than the mom seals in November and December. So that's showing us that the skip females are getting ready for gestation a little bit earlier than the moms were, which we didn't know before. Another hormone we're looking at is prolactin, which is pro-lactation, so it helps a female mammal make milk to take care of her baby. And we're seeing that that's higher in moms than skips in November and December, which totally makes sense since the moms are making milk for their pups, and the skips don't have pups that they need to make milk for. And that higher prolactin in the moms might be helping make their fur grow in later than it is in the skips. And then all the way at the right, you can see that's what the skin sample looks like when we put it under the microscope. You can see a new hair just starting to grow. So that's what it looks like when it starts, long before we'd actually be able to see that seal molting like we saw earlier in the pictures. So I'm going to pass it off to Roxanne, who's going to chat a little bit about the seal's diving behavior, or and tagging.
Can you guys hear and see me okay? Great. So I'll be talking a little bit about the behavior of the seals. So as Jen mentioned before, we're handling these animals during two times of the year. First during the lactation period and then during the molt. And those two periods are separated by about 2 months worth of time. And during that time, we know that the animals are going out and they're foraging. They're trying to find fish underwater that they can eat in order to sort of get fatter before the molt season starts. But because they do all that underwater, and because we're not underwater, and there's a thick layer of ice between the air and the water, we can't just see what the animals are doing underwater. We have to use fancy tags and equipment to actually figure out what these animals are doing. So the types of tags that we are using can be seen in the picture there. You can see that there's a couple different types of tags. The yellow tag in the top picture is a flipper tag, and those have identification numbers so we can tell the seals apart. Then in the bottom picture, the tag on the left is a VHF tag, a very high frequency tag, and that basically sends out a small pinging noise that we can hear with an antenna. So you can see that long antenna there that transmits that noise, and we can pick up that noise with a receiver. Each of the seals that we handle has a different tag, so we can fly around in a helicopter or drive around on a snow machine with a listening device, and we can listen for those different tags. So if we're within about a mile of these seals and the seals are laying on the ice, we know that they're somewhere in the area, and then we can go and try to find those animals. You can also see the tag on the right is a time depth recorder. Just for size reference, that tag is about half the size of my pinky finger, so they're really, really small tags. Both of these tags are about the same size. And what time depth recorder tags do is they record the time of day and the depth that the animal is at. And those measurements are taken every 6 seconds. So from the time we put these tags on the animals to the time we take them off, we know exactly where those animals were every 6 seconds. We know if they were laying on the ice or if they were underwater. And if they were underwater, we know exactly how deep they were diving. So with this tiny little tag, we're able to basically recreate their activity patterns for about 2 months, which is the time that we're trying to study them. So the picture on the right is what one of those records looks like. On the y-axis, you can see that's where depth is, where zero is at the surface of the water, and that's at the top of the plot. And it goes down to about 600 meters, which is really, really deep for these seals. Each one of those little lines is a type of dive. So if you click to the next slide, we can see what these records actually look like. So I've taken that previous record in the top left, and you can see that the dives are in little chunks. We call these bouts. They're basically groups of dives. So if we zoom into one of those little bouts, which is the next picture, you can see that there are a bunch of dives. Some are more shallow than others, and some have what look like wiggles at the bottom. Then if we zoom into one dive, we can see that there's a start and end to that dive, and there's also a bottom part of that dive. Basically, the fish live at some depth under the water, and so the seals are going to that depth and trying to find the fish. If they find one, they chase it up and down in the water column until they can eat it. And that shows up in these records as little wiggles. So what I do is I figure out how many wiggles there are, how long their dives are, how deep their dives are, and I can use the measurements that Amy and Skyla talked about earlier to figure out exactly how much weight they've gained, and that tells me how successful they were at diving. So we can get a lot of information from that. With the reproductive versus the skip females, I found out that basically they're all diving to very similar depths, but the skip breeders are diving about twice as long in duration as the animals that reproduce. So we're still trying to figure out exactly why that might be. One thing that we found that's very interesting is shown in the bottom left plot, and that's that seals tend to dive much more at night than during the day. So what you're seeing in this plot is the axis closest to you is time, with noon in the middle and midnight on the outside of the plot. And then the height of the bars tells you how many dives there were during those different times. So you can see peaks in the dive frequency, or the number of dives, at about 2 a.m., which is on the left side of the plot, and about midnight, which is on the right side of the plot. So these seals are really focusing their dives at night versus during the day. And we think this is because of the prey dynamics that are happening in the ecosystem. So this is probably one of the most exciting things that we've seen so far. We usually, like I said, deploy these time depth recorder tags for about 60 days or so. But we've had a couple tags that have accidentally stayed on animals for about 15 months. So a little over a year. Until now, we haven't really known what these Weddell seals do across the year. They've been studying a little bit during the winter and a little bit during the summer, but never across the entire year. So because our tags accidentally stayed on the animals for 15 months, we were able to see how their summer behavior is different from their winter behavior. So what you're seeing here is a year-round time activity budget of a Weddell seal. I think if you click one more time, there should be circles that show up. Maybe not. Go ahead and go back, thanks. I think I can draw on here maybe. The summer periods are this beginning period, so in about 2013. And the other summer period is at the very end of the plot. So right in the middle is the big winter period. And you can see that in the winter, the seals are diving to about twice as deep as they are during the summer. So we didn't know that they do this. There's a lot of reasons that this might be true, but one of the main reasons is that because it's dark during the winter, the prey are doing very different things, and there might actually be different types of food than during the summer periods. So these are the types of questions that we're beginning to be able to answer with these tags. How does behavior change across animals that have different reproductive successes? And when and why might the seals be diving more? So I'll pass it off to Michelle and Greg, who will talk about reproductive things.
Hi there, this is Greg Adams. Can everybody hear me?
Yes, we can.
Excellent. Okay, I just wanted to thank Alex for this. This is really exciting. I get to talk to you and all my colleagues and people from all over the world. I'm at the University of Saskatchewan in Canada, and as Dr. Burns mentioned, the two most important things in the survival of a species are energy, food, and its ability to reproduce. And Dr. Burns is a specialist in the energetics of wild mammals. And she asked me, as someone who's interested and has some specialty in reproduction, if I'd like to be involved with this project. Well, I told her that I'd never seen a Weddell seal before. And she said, well, that's okay. It's a little bit like a small cow. So they are about that size. As soon as she said that, I felt a lot better. I do a lot of ultrasonography, and we use that tool to look inside of an animal. And it's one of the most amazing tools that allows us to see what's going on inside without hurting the animal, without hurting the baby that might be in the animal, and we can do it over and over again safely. But we hadn't done this before in Weddell seals, so it was an exciting first trip when I went down there. You'll see in the picture that I'm holding an ultrasound probe, and it looks like this probe is on the long, long stick. We call that the probe extension. And it turned out that as we realized how deep the structures were inside the seal, we had to make this stick longer and longer. Sometimes you can see the pregnancies or babies inside animals just by putting the probe against the skin. But as you know, Weddell seals are pretty fat. They have a large blubber layer, and the babies are very deep. Plus, which when we were looking at these, we expected the babies to be very, very small. So we need to get a very clear view, and be very close to where the babies are. So we use this ultrasound probe transrectally. We put this probe into the rectum, and it's because the we can get so close to where the baby is developing in the uterus by this, and we can get absolutely gorgeous pictures using this ultrasound machine out on the ice. Go to the next slide. Here are some pictures of our babies inside the Weddell seals, and you'll see we were able to see babies that were all the way down, so small as maybe being only 7 days old or 7 days of growth. And on the other hand, later in the season, we saw babies grow to what looked beyond 2 months of growth. So these babies, we call them embryonic vesicles. It's just a vesicle just means a little fluid-filled cavity. And inside this little fluid-filled cushion balloon, there's a developing embryo. And that embryo starts out just looking like a gray blob in the middle of our black vesicle. And then pretty soon we start to see a heart beating in there, and after a while we can see the eye and the nose and the heart starting to beat, and we can do what's called color Doppler, and you can see the red vascular flow of the blood going through this newly developing baby. So it was absolutely amazing and fantastic that we could see these babies starting to grow. And most importantly to Dr. Burns' project, we could make a link between pregnancy and nutrition or energy. And both of those are critically important. So if an animal is able to get pregnant, then that might have a negative effect on her body condition. She needs more groceries. And on the other hand, if she's in poor body condition, she's going to have a lesser chance of being able to get pregnant and have a baby. I'd like to ask Dr. Shiro to talk a little bit about what we did with the with these data and how the babies grow.
Hi, so this is Michelle back in Anchorage, and I've been working with Greg Adams and Rob McCorkle on a postdoctoral project using these data with the pregnancies. And so we started looking at how large those embryos were. We were measuring them along with just looking at their pictures. And we noticed this very obvious trend where those skip breeders that weren't working as hard that summer nursing their pup were then starting their new pregnancy earlier than the moms were. So this figure on the left shows skip breeders having the largest embryo size, followed by the females that gave birth early in the season. And then finally, the females that gave birth the latest have the smallest embryos. And if you look at the graph on the right, we've been seeing when these females are weaning their pups, and we're able to see these new pregnancies very shortly after the animals have weaned their pups. So that doesn't leave a whole lot of time for them to pause their pregnancy, or have what we thought they would have called an embryonic diapause. And so what this is the females are bred, and the embryo grows just a little bit before going on pause for anywhere from 1 month to 4 months. And in Weddell seals, we're seeing they may not actually do this at all. And we thought that this was important so that the animals would be able to give birth when it's warm during the summer, and so the pups would be born when the ambient conditions are favorable. And so what we've been seeing, you can go to the next slide, is that instead of having this diapause period, it may be that the animals just have a very long pregnancy. And this was originally a PowerPoint animation. I don't know, will that graph show up, Alex?
I don't think so.
Oh. Well, we think that what this may do is instead of having an 8 to 9 month pregnancy like we thought, the Weddell seal would have to have a 10-month long pregnancy. And it may be very useful for them so that they can spread the energetic cost of pregnancy over a longer period, and that makes their daily costs a little bit lower. And we've also seen in the past project that Weddell seals, oh, there we go. If you look at this graph, Weddell seals are sort of wimpy gainers. And so when they're pregnant, they don't gain as much mass when we compare them to other seal species like gray seals or elephant seals. And so the fact that they're wimpy gainers may select for them having this longer pregnancy, and it may be really useful for them. I think that's it for my part.
Is that your last one?
Yep.
All right. So I get to share with you, lastly, just some of the things we've been working on and how we can connect this, what the scientists are doing out in the field with what you are doing in the classroom. And so we have some lessons, we've developed some lessons, and there is a short introduction, and that introduction will actually focus on an introduction to the project and then also to Antarctica itself, and there's an activity about how we measure seasonal ice change. In the mapping activities, we actually focus on mapping the continents and the ocean, the hemispheres, and then mapping Antarctica itself and some of its major features. And then we also drill down even closer to what we were doing in McMurdo Station, and we've got the seal haul-out sites, and then we have looking at data from those haul-out sites. And then we also have food chains. Food chains and food webs, as we know, are very important curricular concepts, and they are really central to understanding the flow of energy and matter among all living things. So we have a Southern Ocean food web activity for you. And then the two activities that I'm most excited about are the diving activities and what we call right now the measuring activities. So when Roxanne was talking about, you know, the anatomy of a dive and how deep and for how long seals dive, we've got a couple of activities taking a look at that. And then Michelle actually came up with a how we can calculate, by all the measurements we're taking, how we can get an estimate of the seal's weight. And so those activities are available, and they will hopefully be available on the PolarTrek website. But if you would like them right now, you can email me at alex.eilers@memphistn.gov. And then we are also going to take a look at some of the new journals, if you would like. Take a look at some of those new journals. When I came back in February, I spent a few days in New Zealand and presented to some of the schools in the area. And then actually, since I really hadn't spent much time in New Zealand, the students told me where to go. So we're going to highlight the schools that I visited and where they told me to go. So these journals will be Monday through Friday of this week, and they will be posted ready for you guys to view, should be of a morning. All right, Janet, do we want to open this up for questions now?
Yeah, I don't know that we need to open up for questions. They've been coming back and furious during this whole thing. So anyway, we have lots of questions that have been going through. I think mostly I got to see if the research team was able to catch up. And I think maybe we'll go to, see a couple questions that came in after, kind of back up here a little bit, after Jen started answering. So let's just go to and see if this question has been answered by the team. Lewis wants to know why seals dive into the water at night during the winter.
Should we have Roxanne try that one?
Whoever wants to answer it, go ahead.
Yeah, sure, I can answer that. Can you hear me okay?
Yep, we hear you and see you.
So that's a funny question. One of the things we didn't point out is that when we're studying the seals in the summer, the sun is actually up 24 hours because it's so close to the pole. The sun doesn't set for the 2 or 3 months that we're there. And conversely, during the winter, it's actually always night, especially during the peak of the winter, until, you know, it gets closer to fall or spring, and then there are some sunsets. So during a big portion of the year, the seals are diving at night because every single hour of the day is nighttime. So that's kind of interesting.
Okay, great. So let's see. Next question, how long can baby seals hold their breath underwater? I don't know who has the answer to that.
So I'll take that. Baby seals, when they're first born, they don't do much diving at all. But by the time they are 6 or 7 weeks old, which is when they have to start foraging on their own because mom leaves them alone, they're able to hold their breath for 3 or 4 minutes, and they can swim underwater and start catching fish.
Okay.
And that's, I was going to say, the mom seals regularly hold their breath for 20 minutes or more. So the young pups have a little bit of learning and developing to do.
All right. I like this question. Sherwood wants to know, what do you like most about your job and being in Antarctica?
Who would...
Yeah.
Amy, why don't you do this?
Sure. So I like a lot of different parts of my job. I think it's really exciting to get to go to Antarctica and see a really special environment, and also to be part of a community there that has all kinds of scientists all working on really cool projects. It's really neat to learn about not only the biological science that people are studying at McMurdo Station, but also the different kinds of science. So people studying the climate and the ice and the ocean. Our government supports some really, really fascinating scientific research. And I guess one of my favorite parts of my job is being part of that and getting to learn about it firsthand. Anybody else want to add anything?
Anybody else want to answer that or respond to it?
Well, I'll answer that. I mean, the favorite part for me is just actually being able to go down there, take the stuff that the team is studying and sharing it with all of you. We have received so many positive comments, and we've had so many postcards that we've sent back and flags that we sent back. So it is just an honor for me to be able to share that with all of you.
Cool. All right. Lots of questions. Let's see. And if we don't get to all of them today, be sure to email Alex and the team, and they'll share them with one another and respond to them. So St. Agnes Academy asks, how many people are in Antarctica at one time to study the seals?
So our team has 6 people on it that would go down to the Antarctic to study seals, but there are other researchers at other universities that are also doing seal studies in the Antarctic. And just at McMurdo Station during the summer, there are usually 3 or 4 different groups of researchers studying seals. And most of those groups have between 4 and 6 people working with them. And there are researchers studying seals in other locations around the Antarctic. So it would be hard for me to know exactly how many researchers in a given year are in the Antarctic studying seals, because we would have to count the ones for the United States. And then there are researchers from France and Australia and Germany and lots of other countries as well.
All right, thank you. Okay, sorry, I'm messing with the webcam so we can see you when you talk. let's see. Mac would like to know, what's the lifespan of a Weddell seal? I think you've answered this a couple times, and maybe are there any seals that are in captivity that you can compare wild seals to captive seals to kind of give us that age and lifespan?
I can maybe answer this question. So there are no Weddell seals in captivity, but there are a few Arctic species in captivity here up in Alaska. At the Alaska Sea Life Center in Seward, which is just 2 hours south from us on the coastline, they have spotted seals, ring seals, harbor seals, and bearded seals that we could potentially use to compare to our Weddell seals in future studies.
Excellent, thank you. Okay, do seal families stay together?
Nope, they do not. So once the moms wean their pups when they're about 5 to 6 weeks old, moms split and the pups are left on their own. The dads don't hang around at all. They're all underwater for pretty much the whole summer, and all they're doing is breeding. So they, you know, they don't even know who their pups are. they split up.
Okay. Down here at Westchester, the elementary, they want to know, is there a visible difference between the female and the male seal? And Jen, you kind of answered that. Anybody else want to add to that question?
Do we have our mic on?
Yep.
Oh, so how can you tell the difference between a female and a male seal? So you can tell by looking at their bellies. So a male seal, below his belly button, has another little opening, and a female seal doesn't. So if you look at their bellies and it looks like it has 2 belly buttons, that's a male. And if you only see 1, that's a female.
Thank you. Okay. Let's see. Sorry, I'm trying to go through the questions. Tanya would like to know about the seal sleep patterns. I don't know that we've asked that question or responded to that question yet.
Okay, I can try that. We don't know that much about seal sleep patterns. We know that Weddell seals spend about 8 hours a day, if not more, hauled out on the ice, and they can sleep when they're hauled out on the ice. But we also know that some species of seals will spend many, many days in the water without getting out of the water, which suggests that they can probably sleep while they're underwater as well. And sometimes if you go to an aquarium or a zoo, you might see a seal lying on the bottom of their tank, and we think that that's an evidence when the seals are just resting calmly underwater, and they might even be asleep underwater. But obviously they have to breathe, so somehow they know when they have to come up to the surface to breathe if they are sleeping in the water.
Excellent. Okay. Somebody is asking, are baby seals born just like humans? If not, how are they born?
Yes, they're born just like humans. Sometimes they come out head first, sometimes they come out flipper first. And other than that, it's just like humans. We have noticed that sometimes if the weather is really bad, there aren't a whole lot of pups born. And then the next really nice day, we see a whole bunch of pups born. So there is some suggestion that they might be able to wait just a little bit for a little bit better weather sometimes.
All right, and we'll take a few more questions before we kind of wrap up here. This was an interesting question. I don't know if Skylar, you want to elaborate on it, but somebody was asking about what animals hunt the seals, and you responded with orcas. I guess I didn't know there were orcas down there near Antarctica. Is that the only predator?
Hi. Yeah, so typically the ice creates a very nice barrier for the seals to haul out on and stay far away from the orcas, since the orcas can't get very close to the ice layers. But during the summertime, when the ice starts to melt away and when there's a big, the ship that comes in to supply McMurdo breaks apart a lot of the ice, so there are more orcas coming through closer to McMurdo than normal.
Cool. And there's a couple questions that are related to seals and food. Can you talk a little bit about what the seals eat?
Roxanne, you want to take that one?
Okay. Yeah, sure. So Jen just answered the question a little bit. They eat a mixture of small fish, large fish, and some squid. We are actually studying what they eat, like Amy said, by taking a little bit of a whisker sample. And because the whisker sample has signals from the fish that they're eating, we're able to backtrack and tell what types of fish the seals were eating and when. So I saw a question also about how these animals are foraging underwater. Because it's really dark underwater, these animals are primarily using their whiskers as sensory systems. So their whiskers can actually detect little vibrations in the water column that are left behind by fish trails. It's called a wake. And so those whiskers are really important for a variety of reasons, which is why we only take one in order to look at what the animals are eating.
All right. Great. And this question has come up a couple of times from Westchester. They've been trying to figure out what tools do you use to take those samples?
I can tackle that one again. We have a lot of gear that we take with us every day. It takes about 2 snow machine sleds that are about 10 feet long to take all of our gear with us. And that gear weighs about 300 pounds, just the gear that we're taking to weigh the animals and take the samples. So for example, to weigh the animals, we have a really long, tall tripod and a really long tarp that we use. In order to take measurements, we have measuring tape. We have a couple scale bars that we use to take height and width measurements. In order to drug the animals, we have a big net that we use to capture the seals. The veterinarians have a lot of drugs that they use to anesthetize the seals. We have a lot of needles and syringes and medical equipment in order to take the blubber and skin samples. So there's a lot of different tools that we have to use, and that's one of the most challenging aspects of our jobs, is to make sure that we have everything with us every day, and that the cold doesn't get in the way of us doing the science that we need to do. Yeah, that's a great question.
I thought this was an interesting question, too. Are the Weddell seals thriving, threatened, or endangered?
The local population of Weddell seals in the area we are working in is very stable. Population has not been increasing or decreasing over the last while. We have not as good of an idea of what's happening in the overall population all around the Antarctic, but in most places where they're studied, the Weddell seal population is healthy and stable.
Okay, we'll take this last question from Tyla, and then we're gonna take you guys all to a thank you slide here in a moment. But Gracelyn would like to know, how many total seals are there in Antarctica?
There are approximately 700,000 Weddell seals, but then there are five other species of seals in the Antarctic. So they're Weddell seals that we've been studying. They're crab-eater seals that are one of the most abundant seal species on the planet. And their current estimate of crab-eater seals is around 7 million crab-eater seals. There are also Ross seals, named after James Clark Ross again. There are leopard seals and southern elephant seals and Antarctic fur seals. And if you added all of the seals up, I don't actually know how many you would have, because I don't have the numbers for each of the other species on the tip of my brain.
Good job. Thank you. So, thank you, everybody. I was talking to Alex, and if you have additional questions that didn't get answered today, you can go to the Polar Trek website and post them under the for the team, and she'll get those answered for you, or you can feel free to email her. Before we leave here, I just wanted to let you know that there will be an archive of this event, and we'll post it online and share it with everybody that's registered.